Hello everyone, I am Akshat and today along with Purav, we'll talk briefly about a powertrain's intake manifold. Now it's recommended that you watch our video on the fundamentals of powertrain before proceeding with this video. The link will appear in the description. So let's start with the intake manifold guidelines that we must follow in our competition. The first rule states that all air and fuel control system components, including the throttle and the entire air intake system and the air filter, must be located within the surface defined by the top of the roll bar and the outside edge of the four wheels. That is, all these parts should come within this region in our car. Let's move on to the next rule. The second rule states that this chassis structure must protect all portion of the air intake system that is less than 350 mm above the ground from any side or rear impact collisions. Let's move on to the third rule. The third rule states that a throttle body must be present in our vehicle and the sequence for our naturally aspirated engine must be the throttle body first, then the restrictor, and then the engine. And also there is a restriction in the size of the diameter of our restrictor, which is limited to 20 mm for our gasoline fueled vehicles. Let's move on to the introduction. So the intake manifold is simply a series of pipes that provide air to the engine cylinder, allowing the appropriate amount of air to mix with the appropriate amount of fuel. IC engines typically use a four-stroke process, with the first stroke sucking air from the plenum into the cylinder via an inlet valve. The intake valve is then closed for the compression, combustion, and exhaust strokes. Okay. The intake manifold is actually in charge of ensuring that the cylinder receives the same amount of air whenever the valve opens for each intake stroke. The intake system hence governs how the engine actually performs at various RPMs. So let's focus on the main parts of the air intake. So the first would be the air filter, which is normally a special type of paper which is conical in shape and provides filtered air and prevents any dirt or dust particles to enter in the engine. The next is the throttle body. It contains a throttle system which controls the airflow, which helps in actually regulating the required air and fuel mixture ratio. So the next part is then the restrictor, which is used to restrict the mass flow rate into the engine, and that actually ensures that all the car's engine have roughly the same power. Then we move on to the plenum, which is the largest structure in any intake manifold. Its role is to act as a reservoir of air that provides the engine with an uninterrupted supply of air. So now let's look into each of these parts in a bit detail. So Purav will now talk about the throttle body.
So let's start with throttle body.
Throttle body is located between the air filter and the restrictor. It contains a throttle system which controls the airflow, which helps in regulating the air-fuel mixture ratio required to ignite the engine. The throttle pressure is regulated by the throttle body temperature sensor, which measures the temperature of the air-fuel mixture entering the fuel injection system of the car, which helps the spark ignitions generate the most fuel efficiency. The airflow is regulated by the driver via pressing on the acceleration pedal inside the vehicle, which in turn opens and closes the butterfly valve, which is also called the throttle plate. This reacts to a sensor which tells it to allow more air into the combustion chamber, increasing RPM and power output. We are using a KTM RC390 engine, and it is better to use a KTM Duke 200 throttle body since it has a lesser diameter. It is observed that at a certain point during throttling by the 390's throttle body, at an early point, the 20 mm restrictor gets saturated with airflow and rest of the throttle travel is of no use. But due to a decrease in diameter of the 200's throttle body, this point shifts to a much later stage, increasing the throttle response of the engine.
So, continuing with the restrictor, the intake restrictor is a component which is mandated by the rules of FSA competition, in which all the air entering the engine must go through this 20 mm diameter gap so that the mass flow rate of air is same for all the FSA teams. There are two types of restrictors. The first one is orifice plate and second one is Venturi tubes. On the left side, we have the orifice plate restrictor, and on the right side, we have the Venturi tube one. So the orifice plate is a simple rectangular plate which has a hole drilled in it, and the Venturi tube has a converging section, a diverging section, and a throat in between which has a diameter of 20 mm. It is seen that orifice plate has a coefficient of discharge between 0.58 to 0.65. while the Venturi tube has a coefficient of discharge between 0.95 to 0.975. And the pressure loss is medium in case of orifice plate, while the pressure loss is very, very low in Venturi tube. But the manufacturing cost of Venturi tube is high as compared to the orifice plate one. Considering our design, we have used the Venturi tube type restrictor. So after designing the restrictor in SolidWorks, we do the CFD analysis of it, and the final model is selected on the basis of minimum pressure loss between the inlet and the outlet face. So for our design, we had calculated the best converging and diverging angle as 12 degrees and 6 degrees respectively for a Venturi tube type restrictor. We can see that the velocity of air was maximum at the center as the area was minimum, and the velocity then reduced as the area increased. And it was also observed that there was no choke flow at the throat. So here are the three different iterations of the CFD analysis of the Venturi tube restrictor. And we can also observe that the pressure difference is the lowest in this case when the converging angle is 12 degrees and diverging angle is 6 degrees.
Okay, so let's now focus on the plenum of our intake manifold. So the plenum that serves as a reservoir storing the air until it's actually ready to be injected into the combustion cylinder. So now let's talk about the shape of the plenum. Generally, the shape of any plenum is spherical or elliptical. So when using a single cylinder engine with only one intake port, the spherical shape of the plenum is preferred as it actually provides a proper airflow path into the cylinder. So let's talk about the size of the plenum. So the size of the plenum in the intake system has a direct impact on the engine performance. Aside from fitting this plenum, which is the largest component of our intake system, within the confines which were there in the guidelines, it also must meet actually the engine's steady state and transient requirements. The plenum of our intake system must be at least the size of our engine capacity. But this is the bare minimum which it should fit. But it is recommended that the size should be at least somewhere between 3 or 4 times the engine's capacity. This actually allows the engine to draw air while maintaining a stable pressure in the manifold. Okay, so here this is an ANSYS simulation of a plenum. Here there is some nominal turbulence which actually helps in the mixing of air and fuel before entering the combustion chamber. And here we can see there are no like vortexes forming which actually hinders the flow, airflow into this combustion chamber. here we can now see the pressure distribution in a plenum. So the pressure in the plenum is actually a bit higher, so that actually ensures that as soon as the intake valve is opened, it will push the air and fuel mixture into the combustion chamber. So this actually helps the air to move smoothly. Okay, so now Purav will talk about the intake runners.
Moving on to the intake runner. The runner of an intake system is the primary tuning tool for modifying volumetric efficiency. Here we can see the runners. This runner length can be calculated through Ricardo wave simulation software. But in our design, the plenum directly connects with the engine. So here is the plenum, here is the engine. And there is no intake runner as we are using a single cylinder engine.
Thank you.